Dear friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Anatoma, a series of YouTube videos on the gross anatomy of the body. Here we will cover this particular video. We will cover the gross features of the parotid gland. I'm Dr. Balasubramanian. I work here as a professor in the Department of Anatomy, St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, India. Now, here, this is the opening slide. Left half of the face is dissected to show the parotid gland in situ and the structures. It's a superficial dissection. Therefore, structures in its immediate vicinity. Even the whole parotid is not shown here. Nevertheless, the structures emerging from its anterior, but some features are very clearly seen. To that extent, we will use this as an opening slide. Let's get the orientation. I already told you this is the left half of the face. Still, for the first timer, I will lead you to a small orientation. That's the mouth and the left eye, intentionally covered with a flower to reduce the identification of the person. Next, the parotid gland is there in the lower part of the photograph. You can see the apex lower down, the anterior border in front. To small extent, the superior border is also visible. Then this model is added to supplement your understanding of the location and the orientation. Now you see apex, anterior border is shown in both the model as well as in the specimen. And as I told you, the upper border is also visible. In addition, very important structure emerging from the anterior border, the parotid duct is also labeled. Next. At least in the model, we are able to identify the external carotid artery going into the parotid gland, and close by is the submandibular gland. Although it's not a part of today's discussion, it does come in the view as a neighboring structures. Now, here is a dry skull, left lateral view. The parotid gland is embedded on a floor which roughly encompasses these features. The superficial surface is reasonably flat, but the deep surface is raised and lowered to conform with the details of the bony features that you see here. Now, that's the mandibular fossa, the first item, and the zygomatic process. It has been cut here as a small part to show the infratemporal fossa in greater detail. You can also see the anterior wall of the external acoustic meatus, which is nothing but the tympanic plate, a very, very important posterior relation, or rather superior and posterior relation. Traced down, it continues into the styloid process, base of the styloid process. So I shown you the styloid process as an additional point. Styloid process is an important deep relation. In fact, the styloid apparatus consisting of the styloid process, the ligaments attached to it, the muscles attached to it, are all deep to the parotid gland. Next, another left lateral view, dry skull with the mandible in position. The previous one had removed the mandible to show the deeper structures, particularly the styloid and others, in greater detail. But in reality, the mandible is there, and therefore the mandibular fossa is occupied. The ramus of the mandible is shown. The anterior upper projection, to where the temporalis muscle is attached, is partly hidden by the zygomatic process, and posteriorly the mandible, head of the mandible, you can see articulating with the mastoid process. As I told you, the anterior coronoid process is partly hidden. Next, let's try to understand the surfaces and borders slightly in a better way using a cross section, because this is where you can get the orientation best. Although I have shown you a few in the wet specimen, the regular dissected specimen. Now that projecting arrow, that white arrow, refers to the location of the parotid gland. Is a horizontal section roughly through the body of the mandible. You can see the mandible there, that's the posterior border of the mandible. Wrapping it is the parotid gland. Deep to the mandible is the medial pterygoid muscle, and that is the anteromedial, deep surface of the parotid gland, that is divided into an anteromedial surface and a posteromedial surface. Of course, that's the superficial surface which we have seen in the regular dissection. In addition to the surfaces, we can also identify the borders. Medial border, it's quite deep. You see, it's very close or proximal to the pharyngeal wall. The posterior border, see, it's very close to the mastoid process. The mastoid is not shown here. And an anterior border. The anterior border is outside or superficial to the ramus of the mandible. Now, also note, particularly the medial border and the posteromedial surface, its close relationship to the two major vessels, internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. Also note the pharyngeal wall, the muscle fibers of the pharyngeal wall are very well seen in this cross section, how close it is to the medial border and the adjacent surface. Now, some of the students who seem to benefit from this video series can consider subscribing to this channel, VBS Anatoma. In addition, if you press the bell button, you will get periodic updates as and when new videos are added on. Next, here is a cross section of the head region. It's a horizontal section. The point is, this horizontal section, as I've always been telling, it's just not the cross section that you need to add to your armamentarium of slides, but also a few relevant imaging modalities. That's why I have added this CT scan horizontal section. Let's see at what level we are and what structures we can identify in relation to the parotid at this level. First one, that's the hard palate, that gives you a rough estimate of where we are, a horizontal section roughly at the level of the hard palate. Just grab a dry skull, you will get to an orientation roughly at this level what all other structures you are likely to see. You will understand best if you have a skull at this stage of learning. Next, behind the hard palate, you can see the pharyngeal cavity, and more importantly, in the region of the pharynx, you can see the pterygoid plates and the pterygoid muscles on either sides. Medial pterygoid and the lateral pterygoid muscles, the pterygoid plate and the pterygoid muscles. The medial pterygoid is on the outer side and the lateral pterygoid is on the inner side. Next, that is the parotid gland. You see, outside to this plane of the pterygoid plates, that triangular area, slightly darker or darkish in complexion, is the parotid gland. Here also you can see the superficial surface, the anteromedial surface and the posteromedial surface, although I have not labeled it at this point of time. Next, same CT in a coronal section. Particularly, you can see there is a red circle with a dashed line highlighting the temporomandibular joint. Now, that joint will be a very important landmark for identification of the parotid gland. Now, the parotid gland is the area immediately superficial to this. In fact, you can see the entire ramus of the mandible below the joint. So that gives a very clear view that the parotid is the area, the part of the parotid that is outer to this ramus of the mandible. Now that, therefore, temporomandibular joint first, that's the identification. Next, you can see that's the parotid gland. As you trace this coronal section more and more posteriorly, the superficial and the deep lobes of the parotid gland merge into a single gland. But at this plane of section, the superficial and the deep lobes are completely separated. The deep lobe is on the inner aspect of this ramus of the mandible. Next, when you look at the important structures in relation or inside the gland as well as in that immediate vicinity outside the gland, one structure stands out, namely the facial nerve branches. Collectively, the facial nerve branches stand out. Now let's see what are the details. That's the temporal part of the facial nerve, temporal branch, upper and lower zygomatic, buccal, marginal mandibular, cervical. You see, I repeat, from above downwards, temporal, upper and lower zygomatic, buccal, marginal mandibular, and cervical. Now, let me draw your attention to state that this is a well dissected specimen where we have actually, in the dissection, we have retained the stem of the facial nerve and its branches, and we have actually removed the parotid gland. Therefore, what I am showing you here is virtually a replica of the parotid gland virtually placed there just for the sake of orientation. Now let's digitally remove that virtual parotid. You see, now you see, you can see the branches of the facial. Now let's try to trace it up to the root. You see, the facial nerve, as it emerges, it gives a branch to the posterior belly of the digastric and the divides into two branches, a temporozygomatic and a cervicofacial branch. Two branches, an upper branch and a lower branch. You can even call it as upper division and lower division. You see. Now, we have dissolved the gland again. This is another view to show the arteries inside the parotid gland. Arteries, remember arteries. I have already shown you in the model the external carotid artery entering the gland close to the apex on its lower surface. Now, that artery in the substance of the gland divides into maxillary artery and superficial temporal artery. Now, only the maxillary I have shown because that's visible in this dissection. But please note the parotid has been removed. Now, just to complete the orientation, I will also show you certain important structures, not necessarily arteries, in its vicinity. Now, that is the lingual and the inferior alveolar. Now, therefore, this is more a dissection of the infratemporal fossa to bring home the immediate relations either inside or outside the parotid gland. Next, veins inside the parotid gland. Now, remember, the parotid is intact, the masseter is intact, most of the structures are intact. Usually it's extremely difficult to isolate the vein because there is a plexus in this area, the pterygoid venous plexus. Hence, this will be slightly theoretical because I really can't show you these veins in the substance of the parotid gland. Hence, a slight theoretical orient. I can show you outside the gland, but not inside the gland. Now, you see. Now that is the retromandibular vein. I repeat, that is the retromandibular vein. The stem of the vein is there and coming down, it splits into an anterior and a posterior division. Now that is the facial vein. I repeat, that is the facial vein. Next, you see, we are beginning to label facial vein. It comes down close to the angle of the mouth, slightly in front of it actually. That is the anterior division of the retromandibular vein. These two join together to form the common facial vein. The label will appear shortly. Next, the retromandibular vein, as I already told you, descends down vertically in the substance of the gland, splits into an anterior division and a posterior division. Now, that is the posterior division. Now, this, you see, I told you the facial vein and the anterior division of the retromandibular together form the common facial vein. Likewise, the posterior division of the retromandibular vein will join the posterior auricular to form the external jugular vein, to form the external jugular vein. This is an important point you need to note. Next, horizontal section, roughly at the level of the body of the mandible. You can see the outline of the parotid gland. You know, you can see that blinking triangular region. That's the outline of the gland. Needless to say, there is a superficial surface, there is a posteromedial surface and an andromedial surface. As far as the visible boundaries, medial, posterior and anterior borders are also clearly visible. You see, superficial surface, posteromedial surface, andromedial surface. Now, in close vicinity to this apparatus, that is particularly deep relation, as I shown you in earlier discussion, the muscles of the styloid apparatus. I have dissected it on the left side, hence I am showing, but the orientation, the blinking triangle is on the right side. Deep to that is the muscles of the styloid apparatus. In other words, the styloid apparatus itself contains the muscles. The terminology is not exactly correct. The styloid apparatus means the styloid process, the muscles and the ligaments. That would have been the correct way of putting the label. Next, internal jugular vein and the internal carotid artery. I showed you in a cross section earlier. Note that's relation to the posteromedial surface. I repeat, internal jugular vein and the internal carotid artery. Next, mandibular nerve. Although not exactly a part of this triangle, I have shown you this in the infratemporal fossa. So therefore, it is shown here contextually because it is visible. Next, the external carotid artery is a single cut section. You can see at this level, obviously that's the external carotid artery because I checked the dissection. It's a single artery and that's the external carotid in cross section. Probably at this stage, it hasn't yet split into the superficial, temporal and the maxillary artery. Now you see, retromandibular vein is also there, but not on this side. I have shown it on the opposite side. Retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. Next, we will go into slight clinical aspects because, as I told you, no understanding of anatomy is complete unless we also look at the clinical scenarios in which our knowledge is going to be applied. You see, I have put a shining circular mass. We will treat it as a parotid pathology. That mass could either be a tumor of the parotid, it could be an infection of the parotid gland. So basically, all that in the name of pathology I am trying to say is, here is a space occupying lesion, maybe a lump of blood, hemorrhage, maybe pus because of infection, or maybe it's a tumor, whatever it is. This expanding region of the pathology, you see, this expanding pathological material, there is no place to expand because the parotid fascia that is there, told you that is the modification of the cervical, deep cervical fascia. Here it comes and splits into two to enclose the parotid and form respectively the superficial and the deep fascia of the parotid gland. Because these are attached superiorly to the bones and lower down into the cervical fascia, this will prevent the expansion of the lesion. One side there is a lesion, the expansion of which is applying pressure. Another side is the unyielding, you see, that's when the inflammatory this thing is well shown, the unyielding parotid fascia. So a combination of both these pressures will trigger a pain reaction. The patient will complain of pain in the parotid region. Say for example, mumps, he comes with a pain in the parotid region. The reason is the nerves are, the sensory nerves are triggered because of compression pressure. You see, that's that beautifully illustrated by that little animation. That's sometimes, you see, it's not always that it's an intra parotid pathology. The pathology may also sometimes show out as a visible mass, and now that is one such example. It's probably a parotid tumor. We can only confirm it after either a small biopsy there, or better still, you remove the material and confirm it on a regular biopsy. Now that flashing mass is a very good example of most possible parotid tumor. Next, let's once again, this is another coronal section of pathology of the left side parotid gland. You can see that slightly there is a white intensity zone. That's probably a parotid mass. We'll simply call it as a parotid tumor. Most likely it could be a carcinoma. You see, that flashing region is a parotid tumor. Next, discussion of the parotid is incomplete without a mention of the parotid duct. I have shown you the duct in both the model as well as in the dissected specimen. Just to note that it emerges from the anterior border, goes forwards across the masseter muscle. You see, that's the masseter muscle. It goes across, dips down, and the fascia, buccinator muscle and the buccopharyngeal fascia, that is there, it goes through and then finally opens in the vestibule of the mouth, as already shown in that video. There is a separate video where roughly at the level of the upper second molar tooth. Dear friends, that was an overview of the gross features of the parotid gland. I hope you have benefited from this video. I would suggest that you replay the video area by area, region by region, segment by segment, many times, so as to get a thorough understanding. With that, I would like to say thank you and best wishes.